Hi everyone, welcome today to DevOx. I'm opening the conference, so that's quite amazing. And also something to say, DevOx was my first conference I ever attended as an attendee, so now today I'm here as a speaker, so that's quite nice. Today I will talk about Jest and how we can speed up our unit testing work with Jest. First of all, sorry for this. I will present myself. I'm Bo van der Steene. I'm from Belgium, but currently I live in Switzerland. I work as a software engineer and a coach. Currently I work on a product that transforms 2D images into 3D images. We provide this information in the cloud for inspectors and everyone who wants to look at their house and measure some things on their 3D image. I also write blogs on Medium, and sometimes I tweet when I have time left. But first of all, I will start with a small explanation between end-to-end testing and unit testing, because this is a topic where a lot of people struggle with. So if you look into unit testing, unit tests should be small, should be easy to read, and it should be also functional. Most of the time it represents a function. So you break down your complete application in smaller parts and start testing it. It can be a class, it can be a complex algorithm. But one important thing is you test some input and you expect some output. If you start refactoring your code, it should not affect your tests. Next, end-to-end tests. Often they are done with frameworks like Cypress, Protractor. You take some screenshots. Also, you test the entire application. You test actually a user flow. First, for example, you load your site, you click the sign up link, you provide some valid details to the inputs and the registration form, and something is saved somewhere. So you test this flow. This test should pass if an authenticated token has been stored. So everything is one complete thing you test. So today we will only talk about unit tests, these small things. But wait, testing is hard. Yeah, you have a hard time to set up. It involves also a lot of work, maintaining work. We need to define some mock data. It's hard to define this data. And at the end, it comes to a set of code that we maybe also need to maintain because we want that our test still running. And we don't have time to do this because we have some hard deadlines of the business. Yeah, maybe we should skip this testing. But no, we should do this testing because in the end, if we don't do testing, it will end up a higher cost because no tests means also that it's easier to break something. Also, tests can be seen as a great documentation for our code. And if you start working in a test-driven way, it will improve the quality of your code because you will think before you write your code. Okay. So what will we test? First of all, Jest is mainly made for front-end code and back-end code. So it will test components and we will test parts of the business logic, like mapping things, if the HTTP call is executed, if our calculation is right, if we have some edge cases. So yeah. We can do it with a snapshot. And a snapshot, it's a nice word. But what is a snapshot, actually? A snapshot, if we take a day-to-day example, it can be like the moment that our son scores his first goal. Also, it can be a representation of this calculation. We have a test. And this test is always the same output. We can have a drawing of a machine. So all these things are a moment. And this moment, we want to reproduce sometime. So if we reproduce our calculations, it's always the same output. So this is a snapshot. So we can also snapshot a component. So that's small part of our UI interface. If we have this code, sorry, it's Angular code for some people that are not familiar with it, but it just generates an image list. And it looks like this. We have some random images in a grid. And now we want to test these random images because the amount of images is always the same. So we have some code that is generated as this. And this code is always the same. But it's hard to read, and if you want to write a test, yeah, it's hard. But we can also snapshot a block of code. We don't want to always test only HTML code with a snapshot. How do we do it? For example, we generate an array of images, and in the end, it always looks something like this. The ID will be the same, the amount of rows will be the same, the amount of columns will be the same. If we give 10 as an input, we get this result anyway. So we can follow a flow. First, we have our test case. Our test case will render UI component or will run some code that will generate some output. And at the end, we can test it against a snapshot. So let's have a look. How do we do it with Jasmine? For people that are familiar with Jasmine, we write the code, we create a component, and we accept that the title will be just example. Okay, but if we look to this example, we have some disadvantage. If I change the amount of images, it will never be tested. So, if we want to test the complete HTML with Jasmine, we will have a lot of code lines. We also will forget some code to test. If we change something and we don't adapt our tests, it will be lost. It's also hard to define all cases. You can define one case, two cases, but yeah, maybe I cannot say how it looks like. Also, to be honestly, it doesn't have some nice feedback. Feedback, what will be the error? It's hard to debug the stack trace. So we can have a solution for it. It's Jest. This is the logo of Jest. But okay, what's Jest? Jest, it's built by Facebook. It's on top of the JS DOM. So it doesn't require Chrome because it's a pure JavaScript implementation. But okay, why should we use it? If we read the philosophy behind it, it's a testing framework designed to ensure the correctness of any JavaScript code base. It allows you to write tests an approachable, familiar, and a feature-rich API that gives directly your results. So that can be nice. But it's also fast and safe. It will run first the failing tests. So if you continuously run our test code, we will first get feedback on the failing tests. That makes also faster, because we will run the tests in parallel. One test doesn't affect the other test, so we can run them together, what makes it faster. Also, yeah, it requires zero configuration. Zero configuration, yeah. We should add it to our NPM, but yeah, you can run it on most of the JavaScript projects. Like I said, you can run tests parallel. That means that all the tests runs in a sandbox. They don't have interaction with each other. They all run in their isolated container. Also, error reporting. Error reporting is something nice. It's nicely aligned. You can read it, how it was before, how it was after. And you can also work with snapshots. We will see this later in the talk. First of all, zero configuration. What this means. If we have, for example, codesandbox.io, it's just an online ID. You create a spec or a test file, and you can start using Jest. But that's not always what we want. If we have just our vanilla JavaScript project, we run npm install Jest, and we adjust our npm script to use Jest for a testing environment, and that's it. Your tests will run. Now, if we look at the TypeScript project, because if you like to have type checking, if you work on a team, it has some advantages. Let's have a look. We installed Jest, of course, TS Jest, and we install our Jest types. Then we run npx TS Jest configlint, and this will produce following configuration file, basic configuration file, and that's it. You can run your tests automatically, also with code coverage. That's the amazing part. Now, like said before, Jest is built by Facebook, so it's optimized for React projects. But if we want to use it on our Angular project, we can do it. It's a bit more work. First of all, we remove all Carmine Jasmine dependencies. Then we add Jest and we add a builder for Jest. We change our types to Jest, our module to CommonJS. We do it for each application or library if we have a monorepo. We change our builders to use Jest running, also for each application and library. And then we run ngtest or ngtest minus minus coverage, and we have our code coverage reporting. But we can do it also in a simple way. If some people maybe heard about it, we can just use Gnarl with Nginx and create a monorepo from scratch, and then you can choose for the option Jest, and it will configure Jest for you. Okay, so you see, it's all about magic. We don't need a lot of configuration. We should just say our application, start choosing Jest. And then we have this amazing watch mode. I said before, it will run first the failing tests. So how we can use the watch mode? We can use Jest watch all. That will run all the tests and start watching for some changes. Then you have also the option minus minus watch or minus O. This one will only run if you have a Git project, because it will watch against the related changes. So it will see, okay, this file has been changed against the previous version, so I will first run this changed file. And after all, we can still use the CLI from Nest to have some options. For example, we can only run our failed tests, or we can use a pattern. If we do this, we first press P, and then we give our pattern. In our case, we want to test only the image utils file. It will only run tests for the image utils file. So that's pretty fast. Now, I already talked about snapshots. So what's this snapshot testing? Again, we have here our small front-end application that generates some code that looks like this. This is our executed code, so we can dynamically adjust the total images. If we run our test, we say, okay, we want to have always 10 total images. We match it against a snapshot. But yeah, we match it against the snapshot. What should the snapshots look like? I expect something like this, but I don't want to rewrite this code myself. It's quite monkey work if you copy-paste these things. So Jest will create the snapshot for you if it doesn't exist. So it takes your first run as truth. It will create an underscore snapshot folder if it doesn't exist, and it will just create this snap file. Then it will look like this. It's human readable. If you're familiar with HTML, yeah, you can read this. And also it gives a descriptive name. It say the test that we are actually running. So the snapshot component, we have an image to visualize. It's the same as we put in our describe and our it. It's also formatted in a human readable way. Then I will change something in my template, because that's the reason why we run tests. We don't want that our logic changes at the end. Then we get this nice error report. We see exactly which line has been changed, what has been changed. If we compare this to another testing framework, then it's harder to read the stacked trace. So if you look at just at create the snapshot that doesn't exist, we already know that it compares it to the stored snapshot, and it performs a diff. But now my changes should affect, because I know what I changed will be the new truth. So I can also easily update the snapshot on a refactor. I just add the minus u command after our test run. So that means, okay, we just update our snapshot. But on the other hand, also, it's all nice if we do it on our local computer. But if we want to run our tests also in a continuous integration way, then we should commit our snapshots. It has also some other advantages to commit the snapshots. You can perform a code review on it. If you do code reviews on a regular basis and you see, okay, my colleague changed that snapshot and I don't know why, because I don't accept that snapshot changes now, then I can say, okay, why has this snapshot changed? I don't get it. So we can use the snapshots on multiple ways. But like said before, we can test snapshots for components, but also for codes. If we look back to our array that generates this this array, then we can also say, okay, except that if I list three images, three rows, two columns, that it match a snapshot. And then it will generate this output. Also again, easy readable, and it will exactly say what should be inside. But then we come to the fact, if I want to test with auto-generated fields or, for example, dates. Dates always changes. So if I have this test, I know it's a stupid test, but it's only for example, I have a created date.now, which gives me a value in milliseconds. But if I run it the second time, it will be a different value. Also, if I run it on my colleague's computer, it will be a later timestamp than on my computer, so my snapshot will look different. Then I get, okay, my created date, it's just like that different. It's 1 millisecond difference. It doesn't match. So I want to ignore this field. I know this field is a number, because date.now gives me back a number. So I can just say my expected creation date should be any number. So I just ignore this field in my snapshot. And then my test will run as it should run. That's snapshot. But just as not only snapshot testing. It has a lot of things, because you have people that are, okay, I like snapshots, and you have people I don't like snapshots. But you should not use just only for snapshot. It's also, it has also some other globals that are very declarative. If we look at all their globals, we have some similar with other test frameworks. So after all, before all, will run both before or after your complete test. And then you have after each and before each will run before every separate test. So that's similar. Describe, we just use it to describe a block of tests to have some nice feedback. And test is our actual feedback, but we can also use it. Describe.skip, yeah, it does what it say, it just skip some values. Describe.only, it will only run these tests. And for test, it's similar. But now we have two special cases. We have the describe.each, test.each, and also test.todo. So let's have a deeper look inside these ones. We can create tables. If we think of each, yeah, that's a for loop. So we most of the time, if we have some calculation or some business logic, we have some input values. And at the end, it should match a result. We have a lot of them. We have some that we just want to test, and we have some edge cases. So we can represent them into a table, into an Excel table or whatever. So with Jest, we can do it in the following way. We can create an array of arrays, and each array inside that array is like a test case. So in this case, we have three test cases that will test the add function, the sum. And then we get like at 1, 1 equals 2, of course. At 1 to 2, it equals 3. So this one is readable, and we can extend this. But I have a problem with this representation. It's not so readable. If you create it, you know what you're doing, but in the end, if I need to maintain my tests, it's hard to read. So we can also do it on this way. This way, it's just a table. It's readable for everyone. We can add test cases as many as we want. And also, if we add an object inside this B value, then it's also still readable. Previous example, it was less readable. This is one of my favorite use cases of Jest to create like tables for testing my business logic. And we can do it also with snapshots. It will create the snapshots for each of our test executions. Also, we should like define a unique value for our descriptor. So you see the dollar total elements and total max columns. It will taken out of the table of our test cases. So if you run this case, it's again readable. We have images, utils, unlist images should match a certain snapshot. Then we have the to-do, and it's not a slide that I forgot, but we can use test.todo to define, okay, I should do this test in a later use case because I cannot do it now. So you can just add test.todo, and we will add some tests later on. A hard part to test in JavaScript is async code. Yeah, the test executes. So if we imagine following function, my fetch data is an async call, and if it's done, I expect that my data equals DevOps. But here, we don't know when it will end. So we cannot do it like this, because Jest will just stop his test execution when the fetch data has been called, but it will not wait after the async callback. So we don't do it in this way. We need to add done. So we say, okay, it's done on this moment. And then Jest will wait until this async callback has been done. But we have also promises in JavaScript. So promises are nice to work with because you need to wait after our backend call or whatever. So we can also run an async call. And for this, Jest is more optimized. We can just say, return this fetch data, and then expect that the data to be DevOps. Jest automatically detect at the return type. If it's a promise, it will wait until the promise has been done. We can not only test success parts of a promise, but also the failure. So we can say, OK, run the fetch data, and we catch it if it's an error. So if we get an error, we will test it. In the previous example, if we have a then, and this returns an error, our test will return an error, of course. And we can still do it on the async await way. If you're more familiar, if we like more this way, we can still do it. It's also supported. And then we come to a topic, RxJS. I guess not everyone is familiar with it, but that's the reactive way of programming in JavaScript. And we can start write tests like this. First of all, my stream will adjust one character next to the other one, and the ASCII code table, so A becomes B, becomes C, C becomes D. And I run my test. Of course, it will fail, because if I have my source, my expected value is one tick later than my source. So I get an error like this. And it's OK to read, because here I see frame 2 is not equal to frame 3, frame 4 is not equal to frame 5, because my value is just one string. If it's like an object, it's not readable anymore. So we can do the magic trick is just say, use the JEST framework, and then I get the exact feedback, the exact frame where it fails. So that means also you can write your own implementation for testing, and you can just use the JEST error feedback tool. And then, yeah, because we test units, we want to mock out some data. We don't want to perform real HTTP calls. Maybe we want to mock out a part of our service because we want to provide some inputs. So if we have this function, we are not interested in the callback if we test this function. We are only interested in if this function maps something. So we can create a mock callback. A mock callback that will just multiply the value by 2 each time it goes to an array. So I say, OK, I have a new list. It will map 1, 2, 3, and I will pass my expected callback. One thing we can do, as our code will map every value, we can say, OK, mock calls length should be 3. But the second way is more readable for me to have been called 3 times. In our case, it will be the amount of times, like the size of our array. But sometimes we will filter, we will exclude some values. So maybe it should only be called 2 times. So we can test the amount of calls. Also, we can test, OK, the first time my mock callback should be half called with value 1. The second time at value 2, the third time at value 3. So we can also test, is it called in the right order or calls? And at the end, we can also test if our mocked callback has been returned this value. And this one, it's not really useful, but we can also mock out our functions to just run the real value, and then we just can use this function to expect the value. And at the end, we can match it against our snapshot again. But we can do it also slightly different, because you can have a mock value, but your mocked value can be different values. For example, the first time I want to return something different than the second time. So if you start creating your mock function, you can do jest.function, and it will just log out undefined, because we don't say what it needs to return at this moment. And then we can do mock return value once. So in this case, we do it 4 times. So the first 4 callbacks for this function will return a value decided by us. And in the end, I will always return true if I don't have any other value anymore. So in this case, I call it 6 times, and then I say, yeah, just DevOps is so cool, true, true. If I would add a 7th time, it will add another 3, because I say my mock return value should be true. And last but not least, we know we have talked about mocking out functions, but sometimes you want to mock out a module. For example, we use one or another implementation, and it's not optimized to use with JEST, or yeah, we don't want to do the real callbacks. For example, in the past, I used some Microsoft service that real calls to the Azure server. So I don't want to do these calls in my tests. I want to decide which value it returns. So I can just say, just mock out my module name, and then at the end I say, OK, my module, if I call this function, it will return a mock return value with this response. And then I can just test it. So I can mock out different ways. And OK. So now I show you some of the JEST examples. But in the end, we want also to migrate our code to JEST. I can imagine that you are currently working on an application where there are like thousands of JESTmin tests, or even 200 of them. And you want to migrate them on an easy way, and you don't want to rewrite them. So also just provide something to run this command with just code mods. And then if you do npx just code mods, it will change your code to the just syntax. And at the end, if you want to transform it yourself, it's also not so hard. The ITS will still run the hardest part if you have a lot of mocked out data. This will behave different. It's a different syntax. So instead of your objects, you should replace them by just.functions. So yeah, just run this command and it will work. So I talked already about the use case, why we should use it. And now I will end up my talk with some tips and tricks. Some can be taken general in unit testing, not specific for Jest. So first of all, make your tests your documentation. If I created some code and I want to test it again, I want to change something into 10 months, I don't remember what my code was some months ago. So if I use descriptive names for my tests, for my snapshots, it's easier for reviewers and for you to remember what this code did. I was once on a code base. It was such a crazy code base. And yeah, I was glad that the previous developer wrote so many test cases, so we were no longer afraid to change the code. There should be like the company take over another company and we should start changing it. Yeah, if you don't know what the code did, it's hard. And also sometimes developers leave, so you stay there with his code or her code and you cannot ask it to these people anymore because they are no longer available for you. So make your test your documentation. Also, test logic. We can achieve easily 80% test coverage. Some people say, yeah, 80% test coverage is great. But yeah, if we achieve this 80% test coverage, then the next question I ask to you, what did you test? Because I can achieve 80% test coverage and test almost nothing. I just test the easy parts that are readable for everyone. Yeah, okay, what did I test? Nothing. So think about testing. Also, these guys that say you should achieve 80%, you can say, no, I will not achieve 80%. I will achieve testing the complex logic in my code. Try to use before each and after each. Sometimes you want to start your testing with some common code, for example, creating a component or creating mock objects or creating mock functions. So do this in the before each. If you test some JavaScript backend code, yeah, you can open a database connection, close a database connection, and this before each and after each. Also, treat your snapshots as code, because you commit them to your code base, and if you perform code reviews, you will see the difference. Also, if someone added a new snapshot, it's easy to read the snapshot and to say, okay, it's true, but the next time the snapshot has changed, you will ask why it has changed. So just treat them as code. Also, yeah, if you saw my example of the images, it's a quite long snapshot. It's hard to read. But you can limit the size of your snapshot so that the snapshots are meaningful. It doesn't have any sense to generate each time a list of 100 elements because this has no sense. So we can use some plugins. You have a ESLint plugin Jest and a no large snapshot option. Or you can perform snapshot diff options. So you have some things to limit your users to your developers to say, okay, snapshots, we can use them, but we should limit the size. The goal is to make it easy to review the snapshots. They are nicely formatted, but yeah, it depends what you put in your snapshots. But that means that's for every test code you're writing. Also, tests should be deterministic. What's this? Every time you run your test, it should have the same value. As we saw in the previously with the date.now example, it has not every time the same value because it depends on your machine you are running on. If you are in a different time zone, even the day can differ because if I run them at 12 o'clock at night at my place, I will have a different day than you maybe. So we can mock out these values, we can mock out the date.now, or we can just use the expect any number. And then every time your test will be the same. Also, test units, not methods. I saw tests where we test every method separately, but some of these methods are private or are just made to make our code more readable. And we start refactoring our code, and then in the end, yeah, we should also refactor our test code because we refactor the code. So the most important, you have an input, you have an output, and these should match. All the things that happens in between, we should not test because we want to refactor it anyway, maybe in 2 months, and then we don't want to refactor the code. Also, this command is nice, but it has also some, it's not error safe. So if we do just minus update, it will update our snapshots, and we can do it anywhere. It's easy to do, but we should think about when to run this command. We should not run it always. We should say, okay, now I expect some updates, so I will run this command. Also commit your snapshots, because otherwise your continuous integration tool will not work with it. It will not be able to test against these snapshots. Also, in your continuous integration tools, if you set up it, you should use the jest command. No other options, maybe code coverage. But if you use the jest minus u command in your continuous integration tools, then it's not so fail-safe because it will update each time your snapshot. So why did you run your created tests to match against the snapshot and not to update your snapshots each time? So, and in the end, you should get into testing. It's hard. For some people, it's hard to understand. Why should I need testing? I can do testing, but I'm not sure if I should do it. I'm not sure if I don't see the advantage. You see only the advantage if you run once into a problem, if you run once into a bug. In the past, I was coaching some developers, and I explained them unit testing, and they say, yeah, but it's a lot of work. Yeah, it's a lot of work. And a certain moment, 2 months later or something, that guy came back to me and say, yeah, now I get why you put so much attention on unit testing. It's because I went into this error. And now I know that I went into this error. Otherwise, I would ignore this failure. I would not test it manually. So you see, these testings has some of their advantages. So that was it for me today. So I want to thank you. I have some example code. My example code is on GitHub, and I will also tweet it if you want. And if there are any questions, feel free to ask them or ask them later if you see me in the venue. So yeah, that was it for me.